Welcome, good evening, to another session of On Being Human. We had so much fun last month that we decided to do part two with folks that you remember from last month, and that is Marty Whelshula, who is a cultural educator here in the Spokane area. We have his wife, Dr. Tina Whelshula, an educational consultant and trainer in the area, and we have Deb Abrahamson, an activist, community organizer, leader in our community, and we have Mr. David Brown Eagle, who is an educational consultant, and my co-host, of course, Dr. Amy Paris, and I'm Raymond Reyes. What we want to talk about tonight is Native voices beyond stereotypes, and one of the things I find fascinating is this whole idea of Indian people being stoic and being stiff, and you know, the cigar store Indian, and you know, and when people get to know about Indian humor, they get to see a whole other part of Indian people. And I think Vine Deloria, the man that wrote God is Red and Custer Died for Your Sins, among other books, often talked about, if you understand what people laugh about, you understand their culture. Because what people laugh about, whether it's in because it hurts so much that they see it funny, or it many times gives you the internal logic about that cultural group. And they also say that the shortest distance between two people is a laugh or a smile, transcending stereotypes and these sorts of things. So I'd like to talk about humor. What do you want to talk about?
I think humor is a great topic. I think to share with folks that one of the things that has been really fun about working with you all is there's been a lot of humor incessantly and a lot of joking. And what struck me last time when we visited together on the set was the joking and how things are sort of a crescendo of humor. And it touched me because it reminded me very much of my own culture, which is Jewish. And the Jewish people have a tradition of humor. In fact, I've heard the statistic that 80% of the professional comedians are Jewish. Mm. And it comes from the pain of the Jewish culture. Mm. And so it can be a real sign of sensitivity, but it struck me, and I had not experienced that with Native Americans before. I had not seen that piece. And it was really delightful. It was heartwarming. It made me feel sort of at home. Mm. That this feels like a Jewish group, kind of boisterous and witty, and it just goes on and gets funnier and funnier. And I like that. It was great. Mm. So it's nice to see that. It's nice to experience it.
Excuse me, I don't understand that. No, one thing I want to tie into.
Give me a second there. You have to give me a hard time. Or?
Well, yeah, I think the other side of that stereotype, besides being a stoic, stone-faced Indian, is also the ill-educated or uneducated, the lazy, the childlike, the laughing. You know, like nothing is taken seriously. Mm-hmm. And so, for me, it's like both of them. When the time is proper, in other words, if you're going through, say, like a funeral or a wake or a ceremony where there's that seriousness that needs to be there, it's there, and it's not a put on. It's a part of our life that we understand, that spiritual part of ourselves that we need to connect. And then also in these same places, when it's kind of like a relief time, then there's humor. And I believe, as you were saying, you know, a lot of our humor is based just on some of the things that we've gone through, that we've dealt with historically, personally, and we find the humor in it. And the part of the humor is we've got to that point in our healing that we can look back now and laugh. Mm-hmm. And I think that happens a lot.
Yeah, well, I appreciate what you're saying, though, about the stereotypes, too. And Raymond and I have visited, and we've talked before when we were talking about the Anne Frank exhibit, and Raymond was here in his capacity as a board member with the Institute for Action Against Hate. We're talking about those specific stereotypes about Native Americans, and I think we should come back to that because it's what's on everyone's mind. Everyone is thinking it and knowing about it, even if they are against it and don't think it's right, but it's known, but it's a taboo subject. You're not actually supposed to say those things. But it's real important. Let's talk about the humor for a little bit before we get away from it. And it's hard to be funny and talk about humor, although it would be nice if you could do it all sort of together.
It's kind of like a curse, huh?
Yeah. Very serious. What did you bring from your background as far as the ability to laugh about things, and if you could characterize the humor? What I noticed was the tone. Again, it was more boisterous. It was a kind of a boisterousness, and maybe it's because I associate a certain quietness with the native culture outside the music and the dancing. I had not seen that kind of animated conversation.
And the lovemaking.
Sex and death, you know.
Sex and real, real stoic.
That way
our enemy doesn't hear us. It's been passed down to the generation.
It's real visual.
Right. Seems kind of like Woody Allen venue to me. It's kind of in that venue stuff, which is maybe the Jews and the Indians are related.
Maybe. We've all been wandering.
Yeah, we're wandering.
We are. But I think that with me, what I love about it is it's a social. It really is a social experience where we're all a part of this. Creating an experience or a picture. Mm-hmm. It's I think I go back to our languages, how our languages are so descriptive, because mm-hmm. ours is a verb-based language, so it's just all describing. You're getting this movie as everybody's kind of adding to it, which it becomes this funny thing because you're getting the visual, so you add on to that, so it becomes where everybody participates and builds on to it. Which is probably that crescendo that you're talking about, that we're all building onto it and adding to the picture, you know, and it gets funnier and funnier as you go on, you know, and it's just, it's crazy because a lot of times it is based in, you know, something that maybe, it's not that we laugh at each other, but we laugh at things in our lives that we struggle with, you mm-hmm. know, but it's just like you mm-hmm. said, it's like this release and it's a way to let it go. So that we're not hanging on to it, you know, that it's a way to let it go in a good way, and then in the process there's a healing. But I love to be in a group because I love being a part of that, the building and participating in the humor. It's not like a joke. Mm-hmm. It's like this funny picture that everybody keeps building up on. And
to me that's where the humanity comes mm-hmm. from, though, and that there's a real opportunity for building bridges mm-hmm. around the humor mm-hmm. because you said that it shortens the distance between mm-hmm. people, and I think this is the purpose of the agenda today is how to build bridges mm-hmm. between cultures based on understanding, based on seeing the common humanity amongst us mm-hmm. all, that mm-hmm. the things that we cry about, the things that we laugh about are really often very much the same thing, mm-hmm. no matter what mm-hmm. tribe or what culture that mm-hmm. you're born into. Mm-hmm. We all face the big questions of life and death. Mm-hmm. They're all the same. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. I appreciate what Tina's saying because it is crazy, but it's creative.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And unlike other types of humor, everyone has an equal opportunity to contribute and build on
yeah.
a story. And it's writing a story and developing a story
yeah.
that
mm-hmm.
you can see, you can feel, you can hear, you can taste, you can all the senses are activated.
Yeah.
It's a living. And it does bring people together. And when you think about the common things, many times that we all know we've talked about before, like even we said before, Dave's salutation and on his voicemail, mm-hmm. he'll tell jokes and stuff about dogs and puppies and, and you know, commodity cheese. And, you know, we know what those have a historical anchoring point, and we know what they're about, and you can add to it. You can
yes.
continue to add
yeah.
to
yes.
it. You know?
What comes to mind for me is that when we were sitting at a movie, at a movie one time, it was just, I think it was me and Tina, and I can't remember who else, we went to go see Smoke Signals. And so that was a perfect, you know, visual I was thinking about, you know, looking at how you can relate to those type of situations, you know, on the mm-hmm. reservation or where they're driving their car backwards and some of the scenes. So it was kind of weird because we're sitting in this movie theater, and all of a sudden the scene comes up, and we're the only Indians laughing, everybody's really quiet.
Yeah, yeah, yeah,
right?
Yeah, yeah,
and then
yeah,
all of a sudden there's another scene, all the other people are laughing, and we're just
a cross-cultural kind of moment.
You know, all those Indians down there in the front row. There you
that
go.
That's true, though.
You can relate. Yeah, I was over in Tacoma when I first saw that, and the same thing happened.
Yeah.
There was two of us, two people. We're hot, and it's quiet. We look around, and everybody's kind of looking back. And then there were some parts where I didn't get,
yeah.
and I don't think it was meant to be funny, but they got it. And it was kind of like when we were waiting to get this started, and we were outside, and we were all sitting there, and like Martina said, Martina.
Whichever,
yeah. Somebody would say something, and then we added to it because we could relate to it. And then pretty soon we were all laughing and hee-hawing around, and we were still building on it. And I happened to glance around the table to the non-Indian. and they were all sitting there eating their crackers. Like, I don't get it. But it was nice. They were respectful to our humor. Mm.
Yes.
And I appreciated that.
Mm-hmm. Yes. But there can be a sense of being outside the circle.
Right.
As it takes off. Mm-hmm. There's an in-house feeling to it.
And that's part, I think, of the survivorship, you know, that we're all survivors here, and that to even the tiniest nuances in terms of looking at like the pointing of lips. You know, we all know what that's about.
Yeah, what is that
it's
about?
It's just that. Marty,
watch this. Okay.
Marty, where's Tina? Marty, where's Tina?
Okay.
You know? Instead of pointing like this.
Okay.
And if you ask somebody where they're going someplace, they ask how far it is, you could tell it's a short distance when they do this.
Real long ago.
That's vintage Indian humor. You're great. Good to know these things.
So with minimum use of words or motion or anything, we all belong. We all are together, and we're all in the experience together. And that's the beauty of it. Yeah. You know, that's the wonder and the nice. Warm fuzzies.
It didn't show the imagination that Martina talked about. Martina. That's
why
she called Tina.
How long have you been 25 years, 30 years.
Anyway, when I was teaching high school, and I said something in the teaching moment, and I bust out laughing. And a student sat there and was like, what's so funny? And I said, it's in the mind and it's in the heart. And I picked up a pencil, and I said, now watch. I said, this pencil is going to come to life. And I start doing something with it, and I start telling a story. And all I did was just wiggle that pencil. And pretty soon, the students start laughing. And it wasn't at me. It was their imagination of making that pencil come alive and relating it to their own experience. And that's the beauty of it. It's the creativity of the mind.
Yes. Tremendous, the juxtaposition of new elements that haven't been put together before.
What? If you ever sit in a college class and the Indian people are sitting together and the professor talking, you'll see them, they'll do this. And if the professor says juxta whatever, and we don't understand it, we'll look at each other and we'll go. Over our head.
Incoming.
Over our head. Don't understand. No, I understand.
I know you do.
But putting words like imagination together, you know that I hang out with the Black Robes and at Gonzaga, and they're real into the origin and meaning of words. And maybe I've shared this with you. I mean, the whole idea of humor that comes in English comes from two words. Hue is an ancient Persian word meaning neither male or female, meaning God, and more in Latin is moisture. So humor, God, moisture. So I often, when you think about humor, God, moisture, rain for parched imaginations, and being able to nurture each other's sense of belongingness and sense of connection with that shared history and the good, the bad, and the ugly that we've all shared. And you're right, when you're sitting in a movie theater and you have even Spike Lee's work or Sherman Alexie's work or anybody that's different, that's not white and male, I mean, you look at the audience, they will laugh at different points and others won't. And it's here again, that bridge of what does it mean to be human, and we all laugh at things, but why do we laugh? And it's that historical context. It's about the work that you did in your dissertation, which I think is fascinating, because I think it hits to the why behind the what. You know, as you do the archaeological dig, and you get a deep, profound sense of why are Indian people the way they are today?
Well, there's the thing about humor, though, is there's a real fine line, too, because humor and laughing doesn't imply disrespect, you know, and so you just know what the boundaries are, and where, you know, there's certain things that certain tribes laugh at themselves about, which then it's okay. But there are certain things that you would never make fun about, because then it's being disrespectful. Mm-hmm. You know, it may seem funny to you, but to make light of it or joke about it would be an insult, you know, or an affront to them, you know, and stuff. So you have to be really a good relative, you know, in the sense that it's like humor, not making fun of somebody, but it's about being a part of creating the humor, and so knowing what the boundaries are, you know, between being disrespectful or joking.
I'm glad you mentioned the idea of that fine line, because then it's not very far that you go into racial jokes.
Yeah.
You know, Polish jokes and Jewish and Indian and Mexican.
Gender,
we've all
jokes.
Heard them all, gender.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And that, how do you, you know, then the other argument you often hear is, well, every stereotype, it begins with some pearl of truth or mm-hmm. some little mm-hmm. truth. And that may or may not be true. But then when you use racial jokes like mm-hmm. that, then mm-hmm. it becomes exclusive mm-hmm. and oppressive and expressing bigotry.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. In a passive-aggressive way.
Yeah.
It's done
yeah.
under
yeah.
the guise
yeah.
of humor, yeah. but it's yeah. actually very toxic underneath.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. With a
Well, I'd like to add on to what Debbie was saying about the survivorship. And I think part of that is, yes, we have survived. We've gotten through the hard times in our lives. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, once we get past the survivorship, then we get into living-ship, mm-hmm. if there's such a word.
Mm-hmm.
And talking about what you just mentioned and what Tina just got through saying, I just want to add, there was one time a few years back here in Spokane, a powwow. This man told a joke, and the same joke was told like 6-7 years prior. When we didn't look at domestic violence, when we didn't look at some of these survivor mm-hmm. things that we were doing to one another as Indian people.
Mm-hmm.
I remember a man made a joke about, he said Indian love is a hickey and a black eye.
Mm-hmm.
And everybody at the powwow, mm-hmm. at least there was a lot of people that laughed.
Mm-hmm.
About 8 years later, when mm-hmm. we started doing the domestic violence, like with the Spokane mm-hmm. Reservation, we started looking at it, we started mm-hmm. taking a good hard look at it.
Mm-hmm.
And then another man told the same joke 8 years later, Indian love is, no one laughed.
Mm.
In fact, there was one Indian lady that was a friend of mine that was sitting a couple chairs away. She says, knock that off, that's not right.
Mm.
As an Indian woman.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought, whoa, we're there.
Yeah, it takes yeah. power, it takes real power to be able to say something about the humor.
Mm-hmm.
It's a real statement of assertiveness. Let's talk about some of the disrespect and the stereotypes about the Native Americans, and how we can be better educated. Because it's a weapon.
Mm-hmm.
Basically, it's an arsenal of because beliefs are much more powerful than anything else. So it's very aggressive. It's a kind of a war,
mm-hmm.
a form of warfare.
Look, a classic example right now is people accusing Indian people of making a mountain of a molehill with the mascot issue. Just to take one mm-hmm. example,
mm-hmm.
is the Cleveland Indians or the Atlanta Braves, or you know, naming your cars and SUVs by
Navajo
names
mm-hmm.
and all these other things. Well, why is it offensive? You know, so it many times is, or what we talked about last month, the squaw issue in Idaho.
Mm-hmm.
What's the big deal? What's the big issue?
Mm-hmm. The question's coming up a lot. I'm hearing that a lot from white people.
Mm-hmm.
Why is it an issue? And so I'd like to hear everybody's answer.
Oh, geez.
Because that's indicative.
It's actually what I've realized about it is that it's not a black and white issue in a sense. It's so complex because it goes so deep.
Mm-hmm.
But I think that people dismiss it because they think it's the superficial kind of, you know, a topic.
Right.
When it's like the reality of it is that it goes much deeper and the impact is much more profound
mm-hmm.
than anybody can imagine. And so, do you want to sit here and talk to this person, explain to them, and go into an hour of the psychological, the historical, the sociological ramifications of, you know, it's like when you're confronted with it, it's like, how can you explain this complex concept and what it really does mm-hmm. to somebody that you don't know, who's just sitting there in front of you, and I just get tongue-tied. I'm like, well, where do you want me to start? How much time do you have?
And people, most of us like that in those situations, have no frame of reference.
Yeah.
And many times the argument becomes they'll use Indians against Indians
yes.
and say, well, I know Indian people that are okay with the mm. Indian mascot or being
yes.
called chiefs or braves, and
yes.
if some Indians say it's okay, then it must be all right.
Yeah.
So you get that argument.
Yeah.
But the other thing to me, to answer your question a little bit, is about empathy.
Mm-hmm.
The only way, you don't have the time to give them the essence of all those hundreds of years of history, but what you can do, I think, sometimes is give them a sense of empathy. I think Tim Gallego, when he used to be the publisher of Indian mm-hmm. Country Today, I heard him give a talk one time, and he said, it was about the mascot issue, and he said, you know, what would Catholic people in this country feel like that if the New Orleans Saints at halftime had this 5'3" overweight Italian man out there dressed in papal regalia with holy water and incense, and he was genuflecting and doing the Gregorian chant, and he was sprinkling holy water and doing all these mm-hmm. things. I mean, that's the same way when you see somebody with a turkey feather impersonating an eagle mm-hmm. feather or with a drum or, you know, the other types mm-hmm. of things that we've seen.
Mm-hmm.
And he was trying to say, how long would a country tolerate that sort of thing?
Mm-hmm.
Why is it okay to objectify Indian people that way?
Mm-hmm.
So here again, trying to create a relationship that's like a resonating chamber mm-hmm. that you can somehow have somebody relate and then say, oh, with empathy, mm-hmm. I know what you mean.
Mm-hmm.
You know, just trying to come up with multiple
right.
ways to create those sorts of insights.
And also understand that stereotyping is the beginning of how wars are justified. The categorizing, the dehumanizing, and the grouping right. together of classes of people is the basis of warfare
mm-hmm.
and active aggressions of trying to put people into ghettos and genocide. Now, it begins with a construct, and it's powerful. It's very powerful.
Mm-hmm. You know, I just want to add on. When we're talking about, you know, warfare, if you want to use that term, there are casualties. And the way I see it on my own experiences is my children could have been part of that casualty list. And just to give you an example, there was a thing on TV one time. It was a little commercial, and it said the great American face. Boom. Good-looking, non-Indian, mm-hmm. little Caucasian man. Little bit of selling point. The great American face, boom, went back. There was two or three of them. And my son was sitting there, and he was probably about 5-6 years old.
Mm-hmm.
And it came on again, boom, in just a matter of, 30 seconds. And at the end of 30 seconds, before the commercial was over, my son sat there, he looked at the TV, and then he turned like this with his eyes on TV, and then he glanced back at me, and then he went back to the TV, and he glanced back. And what I saw was, Dad, why aren't mm-hmm. you on there mm-hmm. as a great American face?
Mm-hmm.
Why isn't someone like us on there as a great American face?
Mm-hmm.
I do have the great American face.
Absolutely. He has the great American face.
Yeah, the good-looking Indian.
The original.
Painfully handsome.
Well, you know, I tried to do that, though. I tried to figure out what would be the parallel.
Right.
To what the Indian experience is in the white experience, I could not think of anything.
Well, yeah.
I mean, it was just real. I, you know, because it's like, I couldn't think of a mascot or something that would have the same kind of weight. The closest that I could think would be like, you know, if you were an Aryan warrior or something like that, you know, that would bring something. But even then, I mean, just my, you know, just. Looking at my own tribe, we were pacifists, and yet you have this high school football team in Colville called the, you know, Colville Indians, who have this little Indian guy with a hatchet, and I'm thinking, it's nowhere near the truth.
Right.
You know, so it's like, the perception is that it's this warrior kind of mm-hmm. perception that we're savage and we're killers and we're barbarians, and that's what they want mm-hmm. as the sumich, or the power
mm-hmm.
That goes into their game, you know, kind of a thing. They don't want pacifists, you know, so I'm thinking they don't even
not
have
the football, right?
So it's like, it doesn't even make sense to me, you know. So it's like, but they're going, but we're honoring you. We're honoring you, you know. This shows our respect for you.
It's
know, for what? This bloodthirsty kind of, you know, image.
Image. Didn't Hollywood do a lot of damage in the early years in the films?
Still are.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
You know, the thing that concerns me is that, you know, all the uses that have occurred as far as the media and Hollywood and the history books to turn and justify what mm-hmm. happened to our people mm-hmm. in order to clean the slate mm-hmm. for the United States to say, well, we did well. Mm-hmm. Take, for instance, the gold rush in California, where 98% of Native people were killed, and there were posters out, $5 a head per Indian, and scalps for the scalps, and then to portray Native people as the initiators of the technique of scalping, when in fact it was not Native people, and they wanted the gold, and out of greed, that's what happened to the Native people of California. 98% men, women, and children mm-hmm. were murdered for the so that they would not have the ability to hold on to the land holdings, you know. And so that kind of justification carried down through history, and then the brainwashing that has occurred for our people, it, you know, by putting a mascot out there and try to justify it and say this is an honorable thing, mm-hmm. at least we're doing this to you, not understanding how dehumanizing you know, having Indian people portrayed as a caricature, mm-hmm. you know, right. which mm-hmm. is less than human. It's a cartoon figure. It's something that they want to use as justification, and it's not acceptable.
Well, it should not be acceptable. Yeah. It's like mocking, you know, yeah. those guys that go out there and do this goofy right. thing out yeah. there, you know, exactly. at halftime or whatever. It's like, it's gross. You know, it's just, it's so, I guess I just don't understand it.
Well, it's that entitled thinking.
Yeah.
That entitled yeah. thinking that yeah. goes with.
And besides just going into the caricatures and the mascots, teaching here in Spokane back in the 70s and 80s, I remember I was invited by a fifth grade class to come in and share some, quote unquote, some Indian stuff. So I showed up. I used to wear a tie in those days. I had a tie on and a sports jacket, being the teacher, right? And I knock on the door, and I have all my things that I wanted to share and tell some stories and whatnot. And this teacher comes to the door, and she looks at me, and she looks down, and she looks up, and a little disapproving. And I look at myself, I said, excuse me, I said, is something wrong? And she kind of went like this, looking behind me. She said, oh, she said, I was expecting a real Indian.
Oh, jeez.
And if it wasn't for the children, well, I would have said, I would have turned around and walked away. Then we had a nice little talk afterwards.
She was up front with her ignorance. But stereotyping is serious business, and it does form the basis for people to displace their dark side within themselves mm-hmm. and the whole process of scapegoating. Mm-hmm. And so that language is a really important piece, that it be, that there be a passive resistance to it, a non-violent resistance mm-hmm. to it. So I'm excited about the protests that are going on mm-hmm. with these words, and that these issues are coming out. I think it's wonderful.
I just want to add something real quick on that. And I think we can agree that even our own people, you know, we do damage to ourselves. Mm-hmm. I had an older Indian man, a Native American man, tell me, he says, man, what are you doing? You know, because of how I dress and how I have my hair, he said, you keep portraying the stereotype.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And I'm going like, whoa, yeah. What are you talking about?
Or you create an oxymoron by having braids in a suit.
Right? Yeah.
And we don't know, what is this guy having, identity crisis going on or what?
Yeah.
Well, this way is it going to go here?
Yeah, this was brought to my attention one time. No, I won't even go into that.
I think it's a statement about being able to be original and creative and create your own culture and make a statement. I think, to me, it's a statement of self-esteem. When I see an Indian man with braids, to me, it shows, I think, positive self-esteem, willingness to assert individual identity.
But that's part of it, but I think what Deb told me said is really sticking with me right now is it's the idea of who gets to tell the story.
Yeah.
The books mm-hmm. and the cinema, who gets to tell mm-hmm. the story? Mm-hmm. And what sticks? In Indian country, you see health and wellness happening. David's example of 5 years ago, people laughing at the Indian love joke, mm-hmm. and then 5 years later, no one laughing. In fact, a woman reprimanding him. Mm-hmm. I mean, that is a journey of wellness and development and improvement. We want to see, as Indian people, the same sort of learning curve in the non-Indian population. And that's why I think Marty's work, what Marty does, is very important, because it's about cultural education. The work that you did in Enchilam, the other work that you've done as many years as I've known you, mm-hmm. is that you know all this stuff that we're talking about, but you're humbly and you're compassionately and diligently working with the young people to tell another story, mm-hmm. to have the power to restore a story. And that's why I really appreciate and respect the work that you do.
Are you saying that only Indian people can enlighten about Indian problems?
Well, let's wait until after the break and find out, Dr. Amy Paris. And that's what we're going to do right now. We're going to take a little break, and we'll be back, and I hope that you come back. See you in a little while. Thank you.
What if your family lived in a home on an island you couldn't leave? With limited amounts of food and safe drinking water. It would be very important to make things last, wouldn't it? Especially if your family kept growing and growing and growing. Well, it doesn't matter where your home is, because we all live on an island we can't leave. So please, use only what you need, because supplies truly are limited. We can do that.
I see changes in America, and I wish I could say it was for the better, but it doesn't feel that way to me. I see more violence, more intolerance.
Church bombings, spray painting of swastikas on buildings.
When I heard about the Oklahoma bombing, I cried.
So many innocent lives taken to bomb or do violent things. That's no way of changing.
People are really going way too far.
It's okay to criticize the government, but it's not right to overthrow the government.
When you commit acts of violence that harm other people, you're over the line.
Let's fight the fear together.
Need wide open spaces too. Support World Wildlife Fund.
The Dixie Chicks do.
Call for your free action kit with 10 simple things you can do to help leave our children a living planet.
Welcome back to On Being Human, where we're talking about Native voices beyond stereotypes. And Amy, you were suggesting that maybe Indian people have a soul monopoly on a certain type of knowing.
Well, that's what I was hearing you say before.
Oh, really?
That Native people, you said it depends on who tells the story, and what came to mind to me was a story about the filming of The Color Purple, and that Steven Spielberg was brought in to produce the film, direct it, and it was very controversial that a white Jewish man would come in to do a film about black women, and it brought up a lot of issues about who can tell the story well. And, of course, in literature, we have men writing books about women and people from different cultures writing about other cultures and doing a very empathic job. So I guess I'm wondering if that is what you are saying, that I think in joke telling, see, I feel there's an unspoken rule that if it's a joke, about the culture, you can, like, I can make Jewish jokes, it's okay, but if non-Jews tell Jewish jokes, it's another thing altogether. Now, there, I think there are some boundaries, and I'm wondering if like that.
Well, I am saying that, and I'm not saying that. I think part of it has to do with going back to Deb's insightful comment about survivorship. Mm-hmm. Going, you know, I think Chief Seattle supposedly was attributed to this idea of it when he said, this is the end of living and the beginning of survival. And then I see the restoration that David's talking about, saying that now we're going back to living, we're going to get healthy. Mm-hmm. And part of that is laughing at the oppression and then moving beyond it. And the work that people like Marty does, I believe, is trying to tell a different story. Because who tells the story? Power is about defining reality, power and privilege. So when Tina says, you know, Raymond, I couldn't find any empathetic equivalents to get the aha, mm-hmm. you know, when I think about non-Indians, I mean, that is talking about power and privilege. Mm-hmm. They've historically had, and this is not blame, victimization, or guilt. Mm-hmm. It's a matter of fact, mm-hmm. the power to define reality and persuade mm-hmm. everybody else to adopt that definition of reality. Mm-hmm. What Marty does is try to challenge that and then tell a different story. Mm-hmm. Now, do you have to be Indian to tell the Indian perspective? Do you have to be black to tell the black perspective? Do you have to be a woman to know what a woman is? To some extent, yes, I believe you do. But there is also an opportunity to become interculturally competent. And I want to believe that that is what the work is about in terms of raising consciousness and not being about being politically correct, but about promoting consciousness.
I would like to add, going back to what your question is, on one hand, when I was going to Arizona State University, I had a professor talking, and he was talking about the books, and I was saying there's a lot of misinformation, lack of information, et cetera, et cetera. And I have to admire his honesty. Never did respect the guy, still don't, because of how and what he is. In his teaching. But he said, and he leaned forward, he put his foot on the chair, he leaned forward and he said, well, Mr. Brown Eagle, he says, as long as we write the books and we got the money to produce the books, we'll tell the history.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, mm-hmm. Now, getting back to the survivorship and the livingship, if you will, mm-hmm. and what Marty is doing and what Tina's doing and Deb's doing and I'm doing and Raymond's doing, on a large scale on who does the movies, no matter how you do the movies, there's going to be some controversy. On a smaller scale, where the change takes place, I believe, is we as parents, we as grandparents, we tell our story and we share in how we tell that story, and we get to support. Say, like, if I needed some support from an Indian woman's perspective, I know I could come to these ladies here, and they would take, and they have, and they've mm-hmm. talked to my children, especially the girls. And so what I'm saying there, on a smaller scale, without the Hollywood and all the money, because that's what it comes down to, who's mm-hmm. got the bucks?
And who's making the bucks?
And who's making the bucks?
Exploitation.
What sells?
But then when we're doing it within our own story, my story with my children, to me that is powerful and it's valuable, because when my children go out, and they may, and my children go out, their children go out, because we know each other. And if they run into something, then they have their story told by their father or their mother or their grandfather or their grandmother, which is a lot closer than a movie or a book. And then they can decide, am I going to be embarrassed? Am I going to be yeah. shamed? Or am I going to hold my head up and say,
create immunity. Cool. Create right. immunity. I also want to talk about this issue of access to power, because I think it's also a big question that comes up about the Native community.
Okay, but what's powerful is information in a postmodern society.
Mm-hmm.
And the work that you're doing with OSPI, the Office of the Superintendent mm-hmm. of Public Instruction, and I know the work is about trying to look at the standards and essential learnings and K-12 systems in Washington State and put a Indian cultural standard in there. Because ultimately, what David is saying, I believe, is that we want a new generation who are critical consumers of information.
Mm-hmm.
We want people, young people, to be able to look and change what is sold in Hollywood, and be able to, if they want you to laugh at something and you know that it's not funny, that we want to empower them with that sense of knowledge and mm-hmm. perspective. Mm-hmm. And so, you really want to talk a little bit more about that, because I think that is how you create systemic change and begin to change the wave of what consumers were willing to put money into. Because it is about money. Mm-hmm. And it is about being critical about the information that you have and being able to discern and be able to see through things for what they are. Mm-hmm. And it's learned behavior. Mm-hmm. Going back to what Marty does in K-12 and what you're doing at a deeper level in terms of systemic change. Mm-hmm. You want to talk a little bit about that?
Well, and just dealing with the whole issues of power, too. I mean, at the state level, of course, there's the legislature, you know, and there's a huge... there's a special population of politicians, you know, that we have to work with. And mm-hmm. so what we're proposing is not just about Indian culture, but it's about all cultures, all children. And so how can you create an education system that is culturally competent and is equitable for all children? And it's much more complicated than it sounds, because what we're proposing is that we move from a Eurocentric paradigm, from a Eurocentric education system, to a multicultural one. And I don't mean just multicultural, like, you know, we're just this little salad, you know, that we just toss all these little things in. I'm talking about really honoring the worldview, the language, the history, the communities, the family, the deep structural knowledge of children and the way that they learn, because children learn so differently. And not to get into the stereotyping, oh, Indian children, you know, they don't look mm-hmm. you in the eyes, or they don't, you know, they're, mm-hmm. which is not true. What we're saying is, now we're saying, let's bring all of the research, the current research that's been available for years. I mean, we have like Guba and Lincoln, you know, that have been, I mean, their research has been around for late 70s, yes. 80s, yes. and it still hasn't worked its way into, and all of the research on multiple intelligences, you know, and looking at the way children learn differently, we're saying, let's make it into the classroom. In fact, let's mandate that it reaches that child, and that child can feel good about who they are in this system that is designed to assimilate them. Mm-hmm. And so we're fighting, because we're saying education equals assimilation, and we do not, all of us do not want our children to become white middle class Americans. That's not our educational goal, but that's what's touted out there, you know, all of the values that the system promotes, you know. And so now, you know, we're expecting this huge backlash from, you know, fear. Right.
But you don't want to be impoverished either. Well, it's not about giving up cultural identity, but it's also not about remaining in poverty. That's where I see the issue, is that you don't want to lose your cultural identity, but people don't want to be deprived either.
Yeah.
What is success, and that is it?
Deb first.
Well, then it depends on what impoverished. How do you define impoverished?
There's a value laden.
Really,
term.
Because there are people who are very satisfied at living a baseline lifestyle with being culturally intact, having their children taught that way. Mm-hmm. Fine. It's being able to live the way that they choose to live.
It is a subjective thing.
Right. And
absolutely.
It's not about, you know, having a Mercedes or having, you know, the material.
But here's power again. Who defines what you get paid for what kind of jobs? Mm-hmm. How much does a language instructor get? How much does a cultural instructor get? Mm-hmm. And how much does an attorney get? How much does a doctor get? How much does a corporate, you know, manager get? Who decides, you know? And so when we make choices to preserve and to perpetuate our culture, then the choice is, in most cases, poverty. Because it's like, and I'm finding this even in our own tribal communities, our own tribe sets those kind. They'll pay the executive director, they'll pay, oh.
Easy.
Give me the girl.
I mean, you know, they'll, but I mean, looking at the way, so it's about the value of those particular kinds of positions. And so it's, again, but then going back to education, what is successful?
Well, it goes back to an early conversation we've had years ago. What's the purpose of education?
Exactly.
And what you're suggesting is multiple perspectives.
Yes.
And what you're suggesting is shared power.
Yes.
And a redistribution of power and privilege. That people can be permitted to define what does it mean to be successful? What does it mean to be rich? What does it mean to be poor? Mm-hmm. That there's not an anchor point that has a marketplace value assigned mm-hmm. to those terms.
And there could be a mutual learning process. My concern from the perspective of being a psychologist is that the resistance to becoming enlightened about our humanity, the gridlock on scapegoating is because when people give up their stereotypes and they give up scapegoating another group, be it American Indians or Jews or whoever is their group that they hate, then they're forced to deal with their internal demons, which usually mm-hmm. go back into their mm-hmm. childhood in terms of their daily experience with their parents. And it's the internal demons, and that's where the real fear comes from. And so rather than deal with their internal demons, they project it out into a group that they can then hate and dehumanize and project their rage outward. And to me, it's a mental health crisis that we will never cure racism without curing the fundamental developmental work of parenting and how children are raised.
Mm-hmm. I just want to add, I have a minor in psychology.
Man. Yeah. Not equal, but I got a minor.
I can say psychology 101 and 102.
Yeah.
Human development.
Very diplomatic of you. I'm impressed.
Okay, I want to go. I think for me, and I'm only speaking for myself, in my belief, in my value system. And, you know, I think one of the things that happens all the time is we start looking at what's over here. And I think this is going back to what Debbie was saying. And I agree with what Martina's saying. And I agree with what you're saying. But for me, power, and depending on power, are we talking money power? Are we talking social power? Are we talking spiritual mm-hmm. knowledge power of self? Mm-hmm. And if you're going to talk about, you know, all these, because the racism, as far as I'm concerned, it's going to be there. Mm-hmm. Because a lot of people just don't know how to deal with their fears. Mm-hmm. So they project like you're saying. Mm-hmm. What I'm saying, and when I was talking about my children, is to being able to offer them with the support of my community that I identify.
To be healthy.
Right. And to show them that, and when I said when they walk out and they get the bullets, or even the arrows from their own people, mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. they're comfortable with who they are and saying, that's quite all right, because I know where that's coming from. For me, where I learned respect is when I was able to look at my own stuff and kind of what you're talking about. And when I realized what my people went through, what my grandparents went through, what my parents went through, what my friends and relatives went through, when I was able to understand and to accept that, and also to see what I've gone through, the survivorship, mm-hmm. now I can look at you, I can look at Marty, I can look at Tina, I can look at Deb, I can look at Raymond, I can look at other people, and I'm not saying I do it all the time because I stumble now and then, but what I'm saying is I can look at someone and realize they have a history. Mm. And I respect that. Rather than tear it down. Mm-hmm. And I used to be one of the big, and Debbie knows this, I used mm-hmm. to be one of the biggest racist hating people in the world mm-hmm. until I took a look at self. Mm-hmm. Well, and to me, that's where the power is. It's the spirit power yeah. of the individual. We get the spirit powers together as individuals, mm-hmm. then we become a healthier community.
Yes.
It doesn't start out here, it starts here. Mm-hmm.
And defining what is success. Are we talking material success? Are we talking about access to political power, access to educational power? There are different ways. You know, is the person happy when we reach the end of our lifetime? Are we satisfied and happy or not? And what determines that?
And that was the difference, you know, between the ways what we defined was the purpose of education
right.
and what we define as successful, being successful in mm-hmm. school. And we were challenging the traditional goals and objectives of education.
Mm-hmm.
What is it? Good grades equals good job equals good things, you know, kind of a thing. And we're saying, hey, wait, that's not, as Native American communities, that's not our goal. Mm-hmm. Ours is not the American dream, you know, and the pie. We're not interested in the piece of the pie. We want children who feel good about who they are in life, who have a sense of inner strength, who find wonder and awe about the world around them, who can learn through their experiences with other children. But success means that they feel good. You know, that's what it's about learning about the world and feeling good about it and feeling that they belong in it And so it that goes so much against what the traditional goals are and objectives of the, and so when you have that, you know, for Indian students and other indigenous populations that education means assimilation, then right there it's a built-in failure system, because there's no way that they can feel good about who they are if there's always this push to assimilate and to buy into a larger society's view of what successful is, always feeling like you're never going to arrive and never arriving.
So you think,
or not even the non-Indian children ever really arrive, because it's a system. To me, it's a schism. Mm-hmm. You know, to achieve this society's concept of perfection is this psychologically and spiritual like split. You can't exist like that.
And I think it's Indian and non-Indian. It's everybody, because when you look at the symptomology with a culture saying midlife crisis, what that's about. And one of my favorite bumper stickers is better to build children than repair adults.
Yes.
Although that's your business, and I don't know. But I mean, no. But better. I mean, you. No, I don't mean that. I'm just looking at me like clientele. Anyway. You're right, and I think it's about this spiritual vacuum, and that the last century was about the Industrial Revolution. So as we go into a knowledge society, a postmodern era, what is the purpose of education? People are getting to a point of learning about Indians, but learning from. Mm-hmm. There's going to be equity, and there's going to be balance, and equal ground in terms of saying, what is it about Indian people that can be contributory to the benefit of all? Reevaluating how we educate, reevaluating economics, mm-hmm. politics, all those things. Mm-hmm. And it's getting to that point now. I mean, mm-hmm. environmentally it's getting to that point, because it no longer makes sense to the earth in terms of the capitalism and how we've structured economies. Mm-hmm. You know, and there's many other parts that are starting to come to a head, to a peak, that says you need to change, mm-hmm. or you will be forced to change.
Mm-hmm. And Raymond, see, the sad thing about mm-hmm. that, and I agree, and I just want to add something else about education. A lot of times when we think education, we think of the four walls, structured mm-hmm. education, when actually the education of a child is, again, within the home, within mm-hmm. the community, within mm-hmm. the people that we choose to teach our children, mm-hmm. be it an elder, a man who runs the sweat lodge, a man who does the hunting, a woman who does the craft work, the nurturing, the whole bit. Mm-hmm. But what I want to say to that, and there's been research done that proves that our ancestors were doing the right thing. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Do we get credit? Mm-hmm. No. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. We discovered it. You guys just happened to run into it, but we proved it.
Lived it.
Doing the right
thing. No, what I'm saying, I'm being the non-Indian.
Okay.
I'm being the scientist.
Oh,
in other words, our people have done certain things, and now through the scientific research, they're saying, oh, look what we discovered. And we're sitting there going like, we've been doing that for centuries.
That's
but we don't get credit.
Homeopathic medicine and...
Well, just all kinds of things. I mean, not that, and recently, last week, there was a big
humor.
Thing about neurotheology, that we're hardwired for God. I mean, Indian people knew that for thousands of years.
Prayer is powerful. They proved that too.
Mm-hmm. Well, and that's the kind of, that's my work when I go into doing any kind of training or organizational work. It's about exactly that. It's about showing what people don't understand is the real sophisticated, deep structural knowledge in indigenous worldviews, in the culture. And what some people take as simple superstition, they just totally dismiss and don't realize what they're missing out as far as the knowledge that is there and the wisdom of hundreds of years of observation. You know, and so it's like, you know, I remember when I was 15 and this elder woman said, you know, if you're a crybaby, your baby's going to be a crybaby, you know. And I just like, I'm going, oh my God, she called me a crybaby. And I just felt really bad, and I just thought she insulted me, you know, and stuff. And it wasn't until years later that I was able to read about what happens in utero with children if the mother goes through stress,
right.
And then how you emit the cortisol, and then accumulated levels of cortisol create this birth stress. It's mm-hmm. like they virtually float in anxiety, mm-hmm. which is like low-level shock treatments, and the babies are born with birth stress. You know, and so all of a sudden, like you say, science is coming around. They're coming full circle. And you know, their NASA is connecting with tribal elders around the world to help solve the problem of global warming, because science is finally beginning to admit that they've had their ladder up against the wrong building the whole time, that their knowledge is incomplete.
Right, that's right. Mm-hmm.
And then, so then my dissertation is healing through decolonization, but it's about psychology, and it's about looking at how psychology perpetuates the genocide, you know, in our society. And psychology and psychological techniques don't work with Indian people. Yeah.
And that's what I meant by not only learn about, don't be an anthropologist,
yeah.
learn from.
Yeah.
But there's got to be shared power
yes.
with that sort of mutuality
Learning.
That says, I'm going to learn from
yeah,
you,
right.
not only about you.
Yeah.
Because you learn about people, you just don't have this kind of pedestrian perspective about who the other is.
Yes.
But what you're suggesting and what David's saying is that, no, it's time now to validate what people have known for thousands of years.
Yeah.
I'm not
yeah.
sure, you may have a different view of when you say psychology doesn't work. Are you talking about mental health care?
Yes.
Uh-oh.
No,
it's
discipline of psychology. I'm talking about Western science
yeah, okay.
and psychology.
I don't equate those
yeah.
two.
Well, they come from that. They're derived from a certain theory about what mental health is. And the interesting thing about it is that we are opposites. So the Western worldview and the indigenous are almost totally opposite. And so it just doesn't work. In fact, I refer to myself as a recovering psychotherapist because I realize that system just isn't about healing. Mm-hmm. It's about helping people function in insanity, and it's not really about moving them through a healing process.
I guess I'd say I think that's a pretty big category,
mm-hmm.
okay, because psychotherapy is very diverse
mm-hmm.
and not necessarily restricted down to, I'm not sure what, that's pretty diverse.
Mm-hmm. Well,
I would say that's a generalization mm-hmm. of psychotherapy. I think good psychotherapy is holistic.
But what Tina is talking about, I think, and help me out, is it helping people to adapt to crazy making versus wanting to change the crazy making? Adapting
that's
to what?
That's not what I do.
What?
And
no,
all
no,
I'm
no,
saying
no,
it's
no.
not what I
right.
do, and
mm-hmm.
so I think that we need
that
to be careful.
Well,
it's like saying that vitamin C is only good for white people and not good for indigenous people, and I think there are some things in healing principles that are cross-cultural, and that to be a good healer that are universally human.
This
I think that there are
topic.
Healing principles.
Uh-oh,
yeah, this would be another topic.
How much time do we have?
If you're a surgeon and you're doing a bypass, it doesn't matter whether it's a Chinese or a Native American or...
Well, we've talked about Angelus Arians were trying to attempt universality across linguistic, cultural, mm-hmm. gender differences. And then there are just distinct differences
mm-hmm.
because of what you're talking
but
about.
Is there nothing universal?
But there is and there isn't. I think what Tina's talking about, there's certain assumptions and expectations and beliefs that are so unique that support everything else. The analogy mm-hmm. or the metaphor mm-hmm. that you used about the ladder being up the wrong
mm-hmm.
building.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that
mm-hmm.
talks about that.
Mm-hmm.
Look what's going on right now. That, you know, the spiritual report card is our emotional life and our
right.
environmental
the
health.
People also
you know?
Do not hold the card to all spiritual knowledge,
no.
but there's a lot of spiritual knowledge that's been untapped. And so this learning is really important
mm-hmm.
and the sharing of knowledge
mm-hmm.
and the acknowledgement. It's
mm-hmm.
really important.
Let me just give an example real quick.
We need to wrap up.
Out of time.
Yeah, we're going to have to take everybody back.
Oh, gosh.
We want to thank everybody because we have to close.
Okay.
I'm so sorry. So
we ended up talking about psychology.
I love it.
A little defensive there.
I thought you were talking. I want to thank everyone for being here very much. David Brown Eagle. Debbie Abrahamson, right, and Marty and Martina Whelshula.
Yes.
Thank you very
Thank
much.
You.
It was delightful to have you here. I wish we could hear about your dissertation more. And from everyone in Raymond, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Great.